Hey there, it's Adam again, and today we're going to finish up our talk on toxicology. We'll finish up the lecture that I was not able to get all the way through on Monday, and then we'll continue on with part two, which is a separate PowerPoint that is uploaded on the website. So, continue on with our talk of illicit substances. First thing we'll talk about today, we covered cocaine as the last thing we talked about on Monday, and then kind of in the same vein. Very similar in actions, you'll have the amphetamines. It's kind of interesting since we used to actually utilize amphetamines, for wakefulness and things like that. We still utilize amphetamines to this day for things like ADHD, but certainly they are a quite common drug of abuse, as we'll see in a minute. So the things that kind of fall into this category are going to be things like obviously amphetamine. You'll have your methamphetamine, which is most commonly encountered. Usually, like I said, in cocaine, you normally see that more in like kind of urban, kind of inner city type areas. With methamphetamine, since it's most often going to be produced in kind of these clandestine labs, you typically will see more kind of rural use of methamphetamine. So. Certainly up in Jacksonville, in the downtown area, you see lots and lots of cocaine. But where I come from, say in Putnam County, methamphetamine was much more frequently encountered. Also going along with that would be MDMA or ecstasy. Obviously that got a lot of fame from, club scene and things like that. Talk more about that in a minute and how this is a little bit different than some of the other amphetamines. Obviously, ephedrine and pseudoephedrine kind of goes along with that. And then you'll have your ADHD medications. Things like amphetamine salts and your dextroamphetamine, certainly methylphenidate, all the different ADHD meds will fall into this category. And then finally, the newest class, you will have your bath salts. So these are, we'll talk more about these a little bit later, but these are going to be what are known as cathinone derivatives. Some of the more common varieties are going to be mephedrone or MDVP. the MDVP being the methylene dioxy vilopatterone. So as far as the history goes, these stimulant agents have been around for a good long time. They were actually first used, amphetamine was, as an alternative to ephedrine for asthma therapy. So again, like we talked about the mechanism, they're increasing release of biogenic amines, things like your norepinephrine and epinephrine, and that can work on those beta receptors within the lungs to help to release or to help cause some smooth muscle relaxation, helping out with airflow there. They actually saw a ban after people were abusing the inhalers. Over a period of time, because again, very similar to like we saw with cocaine, when you have administration of these drugs, you're really spiking up your levels of dopamine, and that's going to activate that reward center within the CNS, and that's what causes the addictive kind of pattern you see there. But even then, it was used in World War II as a way to keep soldiers awake and fighting. Certainly, pilots were given this with some regularity. And then since then, we've had a lot of different kind of designer amphetamines and things like that. One of the more interesting cases are going to be things like your Gravel or your Flaca, which is an alpha PVP. That's probably one of the more recent ones that have come out, but certainly all kinds of different varieties of drugs can come from this by simply causing certain substitutions and methyl groups and things like that, and you're able to come up with brand new amphetamine. So certainly things like ecstasy or MDMA would fall into this category. So we said the pharmacology is very similar to cocaine, so you'll see that the amphetamines are going to help to promote the release of catecholamines and also block the reuptake. So basically in the synapse, the concentration is going to skyrocket. Again, that's going to include your norepinephrine, your epinephrine, which is where we'll see a lot of the sympathomimetic toxidrome kind of features come from, but then also the addictive nature of it is coming from the dopamine kind of spiking in the reward center. One of the main differences between the amphetamines you don't get with the cocaine is it doesn't have the anesthetic effect. So as such, you're not going to see quite the risk for dysrhythmia as you would see for cocaine, because again, it's not blocking sodium channels within the heart, nor does it have any kind of the anesthetic properties that you would see used for things like ENT procedures. And so, looking at the different amphetamines, one of the big differences you're going to note is that there's more variety between the different types of amphetamines, and you'll see that they have maybe a little bit different kind of receptor or kind of neurotransmitter pharmacology associated with them. So the main specific example here is going to be MDMA or methylene dioxymethamphetamine, otherwise known as ecstasy, is very selective for serotonin. So a lot of the effects that come from that, kind of these, people described ecstasy as kind of like a very touchy-feely kind of drug, like it makes you want to be very kind of friendly with people and hug them and touch them and things like that. A lot of that comes from the serotonergic effects. You normally don't see that with something like an amphetamine type product. Again, similar to cocaine, there's many routes to abuse. You typically are going to see this either being smoked. You'll have some insufflation or snorting of them. So especially you see that with some regularity with ADHD meds. You can crush them, especially the extended release preparations, and actually get all the dose out at one time. And then oral is going to be another very common way for these to be utilized. So you see more oral usage with the amphetamines than you would with something like cocaine. The other big thing that would differentiate the amphetamines from cocaine is that the duration of action is much longer for amphetamines than you would see with cocaine. So, like we said, cocaine, especially if you're smoking it or injecting IV, the duration of action is very, very short, maybe only 1 to 2 hours or so. Whereas with amphetamines, you may have durations of action anywhere from, say, 12 hours up to 34 hours. So that can be one of the big differentiators. If you have someone who came in and kind of was an unknown exposure, you can kind of ask for how long symptoms have been going on. You know, if it's only been an hour, it may still be something like cocaine, but if it's been like 12 hours, it may speak to more something like an amphetamine. So again, the amphetamines are going to be causing a very similar sympathomimetic type picture as compared to cocaine. Some of the differences you might see is that because it doesn't really have as much on the side of platelet effects or causing that sodium channel blockade, you're going to see less chance to cause seizures, dysrhythmias, and then also myocardial ischemia. On the other hand, though, due to some of the dopamine effects you see, it may be more likely to cause psychosis. So you may have more likely for your patients to develop things like, you know, vivid hallucinations and become very aggressive. That can be seen more often with amphetamines than you do cocaine necessarily. So again, the amphetamines are going to cause a sympathomimetic toxidrome. So again, you're expecting to see a lot of tachycardia, a lot of hypertension. Certainly you can see hyperthermia, mydriasis, diaphoresis. Sometimes the hyperthermia can be very, very severe, especially if you have some of these patients, some of these newer kind of designer amphetamines. Sometimes you'll see very significant hyperthermia up to, say, 105, 106, no problem. And they can become very, very difficult to manage. In addition to that, the CNS effects you might expect to see would be patients being very anxious or aggressive and very agitated, usually requiring some sort of chemical sedation in order to help kind of bring them down and make it so they're not really a danger to themselves or the staff. Again, hallucinations are possible. And then some of the big things you really worry about with some of these more severe cases, especially when they're very hypothermic, they can start to develop rhabdomyolysis, which can lead to kidney damage. Obviously, if they had the myoglobin precipitating out in the kidneys, causing that acute kidney injury, coagulopathy can occur, and then eventually to multi-organ failure. So that's really the kind of the main thing we're trying to stave off when we're managing these patients. So you can do lots of things by kind of managing the agitation, managing the heat. That's going to help kind of prevent us from going down this path towards the rhabdo. One of the things we can potentially see with amphetamines are kind of unique. Sometimes you end up seeing patients kind of go on these kind of bench trips or speed runs where they're doing very, very high doses over a kind of more prolonged period of time, say a long weekend. This is where we can see issues with acute psychosis starting up, and then potentially even homicidal, suicidal intent can be generated from this. So it's somewhat rare, but you can still potentially have it. And then you also end in this kind of washout period. So again, by constantly kicking out more of those catecholamines, eventually you're going to deplete yourself. And so you have this kind of this anhedonic kind of washout period. One of the other big things that you see with, because of the dopamine effects you can see with the amphetamines, you're also going to have this kind of compulsive or repetitive behavior. So one of the things they talk about is this bruxism. leading to meth mouth. So again, they're just kind of grinding their teeth kind of constantly. That's one of the reasons why you would see, especially at like kind of club scenes, if you're seeing kind of videos of those back in like, say, late 90s, early 2000s, you see them sucking on pacifiers. And that was to help prevent some of that teeth grinding that would happen with those. And again, that meth mouth is just when they kind of have chronic grinding down at the teeth, and then also kind of poor dentition just due to the lifestyle. And then also that you can see issues where they're kind of picking at the skin just due to this this formication that occurs where they think they have kind of bugs crawling underneath the skin. They'll kind of pick at them, leading to a lot of skin infections and things like that. And some people believe that even over time, by chronically depleting your neurons of these neurotransmitters, you can lead to some neuronal degeneration, leading to kind of longer term kind of mental status effects happening over time. So just some points about the specific agents. Again, methamphetamine is one of those ones that you'll see. The home production is relatively easy. Certainly anyone who's watched Breaking Bad knows lots about home cooking of methamphetamines. But one of the big things that you see as a result of illegal production of methamphetamine is that the restrictions on pseudoephedrine are as they are today, where a lot of it's behind the counter. You have to sign a registry in order to make sure that we're not buying up tons and tons of pseudoephedrine to make this methamphetamine. So that's been one of the kind of the fallout or ramifications of this production. The other thing you have to watch out for, especially if people are trying to make methamphetamine within the home, is you worry about abuse cases or cases of neglect for children who may be getting into some of the product itself, or potentially even some of the precursors, which can be very, very dangerous, things like red phosphorus and different acids and things like that. And then also the injury from the production itself. So certainly explosions have happened in the past, can be very, very dangerous when producing this. And as you might imagine, some of these cooks may not necessarily have their chemistry degree to kind of back up what they're doing. So again, pretty risky situation. MDMA or methylene dioxymethamphetamine is, again, otherwise known as ecstasy. It's kind of the feel-good amphetamine, and because of that, it has to do with the serotonergic effects, where it just makes you kind of feel very at peace, and you want to kind of be close to other people, and so that's why you see a lot of people kind of being very kind of amorous when utilizing ecstasy. And then one of the other things you can potentially see is this hyponatremia that can occur and kind of induce kind of an SIADH that can happen, leading to some severe hyponatremia. Not only that, but if you imagine that we talked about the repetitive behavior aspect of it, but one of the things that people may be going into, say, a big rave, and they're going to do some ecstasy. One of the things they hear is like, oh yeah, don't get overheated, don't get overheated. So they end up drinking a lot of water, and so that because of that kind of compulsive repetitive behavior, they end up drinking way too much water. So that on top of the SIDH can lead to some very significant hyponatremia. I've seen patients come in with sodiums of say 115, come in seizing, and unfortunately we're not able to recover. So it can be very, very significant if the person happens to be susceptible to it. Some of the newer agents that we're seeing are these cathinone derivatives. So this comes from the Katha edulis shrub, and the original compound that we got from this was called khat, K-H-A-T. It's been used in Africa for a long time for religious ceremonies, and from that original cathinone, we're able to make some derivatives, and this is where the bath salts come from. So it's very similar to the K2 and the spice that we talked about before, which are synthetic cannabinoids. These are derivatives of this cathinone. Again, imported, can be sold on the internet, found in certain smoke shops. Again, a lot of that's been kind of taken down, at least in the physical stores, mainly because a lot of these substances have been made Schedule I substances, but there's always new ones coming out. The problem that we see with these is they really have a lot of these neuropsychiatric effects. So they can have, again, the sympathomimetic toxidrome. But one of the things you end up seeing is that even after those kind of vital sign manifestations kind of resolve, you're going to see kind of more long-term agitation and psychosis for several days in some cases. It can be very, very difficult to manage. So just looking at the diagnostic screening, we talked a little bit about drugs of abuse screens before. Again, this is clinically of little use. There's a ton of false positives and negatives. So if you take pseudoephedrine for your seasonal allergies, there's a good chance you're going to show positive for amphetamines. Or if you're taking amphetamine salts for your ADHD, of course you're going to show positive for that. So it doesn't always confirm acute use as well. So what I mean by that is, if I gave someone cocaine and tested their urine, I could test that out for say within 2 days worth, right? So I at least know they had some relatively close use from the time of testing to when they actually used the cocaine. Whereas with amphetamines, they stick around for longer in the system, so you can't necessarily confirm that just because someone is positive for the amphetamines, I can say that yes, they've been on amphetamines recently. They absolutely are toxic because of this. So again, the urine drug screens are not super useful. Other things to check for again would be an EKG, just to make sure they're not having any interval prolongations or dysrhythmias developing from the use of these products. Certainly check serum electrolytes, especially if you're considering that maybe ecstasy is in the mix. You want to check a sodium, and then obviously monitor their temperature pretty closely. Again, with most of these substances, you're going to see the ABCs are super important. So maintain the airway, get the breathing circulation under control. And then the aggressive cooling is really important here as well. So they come in hyperthermic. You want to focus on getting some ice packs, put them on the axilla, put them on the groins. Look at some evaporative cooling where you actually kind of spray them down. You can put a fan on them to kind of help with the cooling. And try to put them in a calm environment. Obviously, if they're having any agitation, hypertension, tachycardia, seizures, benzodiazepines are still going to be our treatment of choice, just like we see with any of the other stimulants we've already talked about. Looking at as far as like choices of GI decontamination, won't get too far into this, but certainly if you had a patient who had a recent ingestion, activated charcoal could be considered. And this is another case where whole body irrigation might be used if we're having someone who's either a body stuffer, who is someone who is, they see the red and blue lights and decide to swallow their product and try to get away, or if they're body packers who are being the actual drug mules, they have a lot of product in their system. You can use whole body irrigation with polyethylene glycol solutions to help basically flush out the whole GI tract. Obviously, with the rhabdo, maintaining urine output is going to be the biggest thing here. Plus or minus on whether or not sodium bicarbonate really helps here, but certainly preventing the urine from getting too concentrated or too acidic helps to keep that myoglobin from going in, out of solution. So you want to maintain urine output pretty at a good clip, 1 to 2 mL per kilo per hour. And in some cases, if they do have significant kidney injury, then dialysis may be needed. Because some of these agents are going to be affecting serotonin, certainly you want to look for signs and symptoms of serotonin syndrome, which we'll talk more about, or we've talked about previously. And obviously avoid antipsychotics because this can kind of cloud the picture and in some instances have actually seemed to increase mortality. And again, this is just an example of a meth lab that was found in my home county of Putnam County. Just kidding, not really. They don't really look this nice. Usually expect them to look a little bit more like this. This isn't really from my hometown. I just thought it was kind of funny. But again, you might imagine here that the chemistry sets they're working with maybe not of the highest quality. Maybe the safety standards aren't really up to par. It's very easy to see how either an explosion could happen or there could be an accidental exposure, especially if kids are walking around. And then moving on, we're going to talk about another big group of substances of abuse. We'll look at the sedative hypnotics. So, like we mentioned with the sedative hypnotics previously, again, the majority of these products are going to work by enhancing GABA function. Some degree may inhibit the activities of glutamate. Remember, glutamate being kind of one of the major excitatory neurotransmitters. And you'll see that the activity is going to depend on the type of subunit activity these different agents are going to have. But in general, again, they're going to be enhancing the effects of GABA to kind of slow neuronal conduction globally. Big things to remember, especially when you have mixing of different products, you can have a lot of synergism that's possible. So certainly if I give one type of sedative agent, may have a relatively wide safety index on its own, but certainly by adding on another one, you see this kind of synergistic effect on the CNS depression, potentially more of the respiratory depression. And so a good example of this would be the Mickey Finn. So if you slip someone a Mickey, that means putting a dose of chloral hydrate into their drink. Again, chloral hydrate is metabolized to a product called trichloroethanol, which actually inhibits the metabolism of alcohol, and alcohol will inhibit the metabolism of the trichloroethanol. And so you can see they have kind of a cyclical effect where they actually increase their half-life of each other and have very significant effects on CNS depression. Obviously, you're going to see tolerance develop over time, whether it be pharmacokinetic or dynamic. And so you'll see certain patients who can tolerate much higher doses, but they're also going to be the ones that are more likely to undergo withdrawal. And usually, withdrawal from these agents may lead to seizures, which can be fatal. So that's going to be one of the big differences between these guys and, say, withdrawing from something like an opioid. again, as far as clinical manifestations go, you're going to expect them just to be knocked out. We've kind of talked about this toxidrome previously. So again, they're going to be having slurred speech, ataxia, and coordination. Again, most of the time they're going to be appearing to be kind of drunk, but with more severe exposures, stupor and coma is going to be very, very possible, which may include things like respiratory depression, could be retaining a lot of CO2 leading to a respiratory acidosis, and eventually can lead to total cardiovascular depression if they are not going to be managed or if they're found down for a prolonged period of time. Again, here with diagnostic testing, drugs of abuse screens are not super helpful. Most screens will test for benzodiazepines and also barbiturates, but a lot of things are not going to be detected. So a lot of skeletal muscle relaxants are not going to show up there. Things like ethanol does not show up on a urine drug screen. So just keep that in mind, as may not be super useful. One thing you want to note, though, and this is good to remember, that if you have a barbiturate, just remember that butalbital is definitely a barbiturate that will show up on this drug screen. So if you can't determine if the patient has been on butalbital, maybe because they're too comatose to actually talk to you, and they show positive for barbiturate, you can't always get a phenobarb level. And if that comes back negative, then you're pretty well assured that it's a butalbital. Again, want to be monitoring their temperature, potentially get an ABG, look for acidosis developing, and then also an EKG, since some of these agents will have some interval prolongation effects. First, management goes for these sedatives. Again, you want to prevent aspiration, so you may need to intubate in order to help protect their airway. For most of them, if they can get within an hour, activated charcoal might be useful for helping to prevent absorption. But just keep in mind, if the patient is at risk for aspiration, so if they're really, sedate and not really protecting their airway, you don't want to give them charcoal because if they end up puking that up and aspirating it, that charcoal can be very, very hard on the lungs and can be potentially even worse than what whatever drug they ingested was going to do to them. Again, if they're hypotensive, you can give some fluids, maybe start a pressor like norepinephrine up, but for the most part, it's just going to be supportive care for a lot of these agents. Again, benzos specifically, there's lots of different agents that are out there. We know the pharmacokinetics are going to vary pretty widely. Again, some of them are metabolized by the liver, some go through the kidneys, some have active metabolites. But just keep in mind that the clinical effects can be extended much farther than what the apparent duration of action is, especially if they have things like organ impairment or they have active metabolites. Again, with single PO ingestions, the biggest things you're going to see is the CNS depression. You normally don't see a ton of respiratory depression or CV depression. The exception to that, though, would be if they had other agents on board as well, and that's that synergy that we were talking about previously. The antidote that we can use here is called flumazenil. Again, this drug is going to antagonize the benzodiazepine receptors. It's not going to work for anything else, though. So if you have a barbiturate on board, if you have ethanol on board, anything like that, flumazenil is not really going to work for those. And keep in mind, if your patient is tolerant to the effects of the benzos, and you give the antidote, and you force all of those benzos off the receptors, you can induce withdrawal seizures, which can be a big no-no. Again, because the only way to treat that, you have more benzos. Other contraindication for that would be if they had a co-ingestion of a cyclic antidepressant, because again, those drugs can definitely cause seizures and overdose, and so sometimes those benzos are actually being protective. And notice here, the dosing, don't memorize the dosing, but just be aware that as you're going to have kind of a titrating dose up to see how they respond, because again, you don't want to overdo it and put them into withdrawal. So you can start with a small dose, see how they respond, give another dose, see how they respond, and then finally give that last dose. If they don't respond by that point, chances are it's probably not a benzo that's causing what you're seeing there. But if it does work, and then potentially you can even put them on a drip to kind of maintain them, especially if there's a long half-life of the benzo you're dealing with. One of the other things that I see fairly commonly in Florida is carisoprodol, otherwise known as SOMA. This one actually is a Schedule 4 substance in Florida, and a lot of other places you won't actually see it be a scheduled substance. The big thing to notice here is it actually gets metabolized into another muscle relaxant called meprobamate. And so because of that, meprobamate is a very, very potent sedative agent. It kind of puts it in the SOMA coma. And so just saying that there's a very long duration of action for this drug, much longer than the half-life of carisoprodol would appear to be, just due to the effects of this meprobamate. So the main effects you're going to be seeing here are going to be prolonged CNS depression. You may see a little bit of anticholinergic effects just due to the receptor activity that carisoprodol has, and rarely can it cause seizures, in which case you may need to treat them with a benzodiazepine, which can worsen the CNS depression even worse, which can make you more likely to intubate. But again, this is a somewhat common drug that I've seen overdoses on in my time in the adult ED. And then you also have a few non-benzodiazepine hypnotics. So this would be your Z drugs, so esopiclone, zolpidem, and zaleplon. These bind to a specific GABA-A subunit. So it has a little bit different activity than benzodiazepines. They're going to be having more effects to help people get to sleep. There's lower addiction potential with it. The nice things about these, they have a very, very wide therapeutic index. So again, you can overdose on several times the therapeutic dose here and not really have any issues with these drugs. But of note, they can also be reversed with flumazenil. You might just need a little bit more drug in order to help reverse that, since they are not as specific looking as the actual benzodiazepines are. And one final category of sedative type agents we'll talk about are going to be inhalants. Again, this is one of those things that certainly people who have limited income might abuse these, especially if you go into Walmart and you're looking for a cheap thrill, buying some things like toluene or paint thinner or even Ready Whip. All of these things have inhalants in them that can lead to some CNS depression. Again, some of the ways that these drugs are going to work is mainly they act as an asphyxiant. So they're going to displace oxygen. So of course, less oxygen getting to the brain. Brain kind of goes in this kind of euphoric type state. But you'll also see that some of them actually work as kind of general anesthetics. So similar to when we talk in the surgery section, you'll see some effects on the CNS where they cause just kind of a global depression. And so that's kind of the main thing you're going to expect to see with this. Obviously, with this guy, you can kind of tell what his favorite color is based on what he was abusing. Looks like he's probably having an okay time, but probably not having in such a good situation that he had to have this shot taken. Some of the big things you worry about, though, with these inhalants is they can actually sensitize the myocardium to the effects of catecholamines, making them more sensitive to that. So meaning, say if you had a sudden jolt, say someone walked in on you as you're inhaling this stuff, that sudden release in catecholamines could lead to ventricular arrhythmias, and so VTAC, VFib. So one of the things they talk about is a sudden sniffing death, where someone was, you know, huffing this stuff, someone walks in behind them, gives them a scare, and all of a sudden they collapse in dysrhythmia. Other things you can see, especially with more chronic use, it's going to be anoxic brain injury, and seizures may be possible here. And then especially, this is more specific to Freon, so people huffing Freon off of things like air conditioners, you can certainly see thermal injuries, frostbite can occur. Anytime you're dealing with a really high pressurized gas, you can end up seeing this, and that can actually lead to acute lung injury just due to the very cold effects of the gases. Again, for the inhalants, good supportive care is going to be the biggest thing here, and make sure we're giving plenty of oxygen to help kind of replete what they might have been displacing with the inhalants. If they do seize, obviously benzos are going to be our drug of choice here. And then there may be some potential use for beta blockers in order to help prevent some of these dysrhythmias from popping up. Again, it kind of helps to block some of the effects of those catecholamines that the heart's now sensitized to. Okay, so that was the end of the first section of the lecture. Moving on now, we'll get into the tox two, the part two of the toxicology section. And now we're going to talk more about some of the creepy crawlies that you may encounter when working in Florida. So the first thing we'll talk about in the venomation section is going to be snakes, one of my favorite things to treat in Florida. So the big things you're going to be seeing in Florida are the most common poisonous Florida snakes are going to be your copperheads, your cottonmouth. We'll also have the pygmy rattlesnake, the eastern diamondback, and so these are mainly going to be the main group of what we're going to call the pit vipers. These four here, those are the ones of most toxicologic importance in Florida. And then you also have this is family Crotalidae, or the pit vipers. And then you also have one of these, a Lapidae, or the eastern coral snake, which works a lot differently than you see with these other guys. We'll talk about those differences here. Obviously, as far as when snake bites occur, majority of these are going to be more in the summertime. Obviously, since snakes are cold-blooded, they're going to be getting more active when it's hot outside. But with Florida being so warm, you can see bites happen throughout the year, no problem. So it's not uncommon to have, you know, a bite in November or December. They're managing at the poison centers. Obviously, the people who are going to be the most frequent victims are going to be those who are handlers or collectors. So again, if you just have a hankering to have snakes around, obviously you're going to be more at risk for a bite. Children, especially if they're, you know, they have that kind of innate courage to grab anything and want to play with things that are colorful. So they're a frequent source of exposures. And then also men, on the whole, typically are going to be more likely to be bitten. This is usually one of those hold my beer type moments when they say, hey, let me hold this snake. Let me get a picture with it. So we've actually had some facial bites that have occurred due to guys being a little too adventurous with these snakes. Okay, so here would be an example of a pygmy rattlesnake. They are pretty mean little guys. As far as toxicity goes, you're going to see these kind of fall second to the eastern diamondbacks. As far as actual toxicity goes, some of the things you'll notice here are going to be the rattle on the end of the snake's tail. Obviously, that's usually used as kind of like a defensive kind of, hey, I'm sitting here, don't step on me kind of method. But you don't always see the rattle, especially if they've recently shed their skin. The rattle might not be present, and so they don't always make that telltale sign when they're there. You also have your copperhead here. There's actually two copperheads. They're kind of hanging out. You see these more or less in the panhandle, not so much down here in Central Florida. These guys are probably least on the toxicity scale. In some places where they're a little even less venomous than they are here, you actually see that some toxicologists don't even treat these bites with anti-venom. Next, you have your cottonmouth or water moccasin. These guys are typically more aquatic type snakes. See them in lakes and streams and things like that. Obviously, they get the cottonmouth name from when they open up their mouths like that. It's all white. So again, they're probably a little more toxic than the copperheads, but not as much as the rattlesnakes. And then you have the Mac Daddy of them all, the Eastern Diamondback, who is probably the most poisonous pit viper in Florida. And these guys will cause very significant toxicity, which we'll talk more about in just a second here. Big way to identify these guys, obviously they're going to have these heat sensing pits. You can see the pit there that is used as a basically to determine changes in temperature. Very, very sensitive to that. So they can actually, you know, sink out prey and things like that by looking at changes in heat. Obviously they're going to have their hinged fangs, which essentially work as kind of hypodermic needles. You see the fangs here, how they come out, and basically are, you know, usually you'll see end up seeing two bite marks for these guys, but sometimes one of the fangs has fallen off. Sometimes you'll have a new one that's coming in, so sometimes you actually have three bite marks, but just keep in mind, you may not always see two. Notice how in the harmless non-venomous snakes, you're going to see no fangs there, obviously. Other things you can look for is looking for these subcaudal anal plates. If you look here and you see that there is a single row of plates, that would indicate a venomous snake. Whereas on the non-venomous snakes, you see a double row here. Hopefully you don't want to get this close to a live snake to determine if it's poisonous or not. Hopefully you kind of got that figured out beforehand. And then the pupils, you'll look here on the venomous pit vipers, and you'll see that they are elliptical shaped, so almost like a cat's eye, versus more round-shaped pupils in the non-venomous snakes. So those are the big ways you can kind of tell venomous pit viper versus a non-venomous snake in Florida. Again, other things to look at that can change between different bites, looking at the venom status of the snake. So in some cases, you're going to have a bite that occurs where the snake actually injects no venom. These would be considered a dry bite. And this is around between 20 and 25% of cases you'll see this. A lot of it can do with whether or not the snake kind of gave you like a warning strike, because obviously it's not looking at you like your food, so it wants to maintain that venom for the actual potential meals. And then in other cases, it may have just eaten recently, so it may not have really built up much of the venom stores. Obviously, bigger snakes are going to have more venom. And then looking at the location of the bite, if you had to guess who would be bitten where, you might imagine that people that are handling the snakes are more likely to get bitten on the hands. So, you know, men who are picking them up or children most often get bit on the hands, whereas people who are more accidental and will end up accidentally stepping on the snakes, and so you'll see more bites to the feet and the legs. When they do get bitten, essentially what's happening here, we'll talk more about the venom in a second, but essentially you're going to see a lot of tissue swelling. There's going to be a lot of ecchymosis, blistering that's going to occur at the area. You see in these pictures here how these bites can end up looking over a period of time. Again, depending on how much venom is injected, you may or may not see this pop up within, say, a few minutes, or it could take several hours for it to occur. A lot of it can depend on how fast it spreads, can depend on whether or not the snake had injected the venom subcutaneously, intramuscularly, or intravenously in rare cases, depending on where they're biting at. So they contain a ton of different types of components. They have proteolytic enzymes that will break down tissue. They will have pro and anticoagulants, leading to a lot of coagulopathies, as we'll see, and then also some cardiotoxins rarely. So you don't see a ton of cardiotoxicity, but as you might imagine, this might be useful for some of their potential meals. So they're going to be having direct tissue damage. That's where you see a lot of the tissue necrosis we saw earlier. It's going to be affecting the cellular components of blood, so it's going to be causing big shifts in all of your clotting factors. So it's going to be seeing our clotting components. So you're going to see platelets go down, you're going to see your fibrinogen go down, and then you have your PTINR and PTT actually go up, right? You may also see some paresthesias and things like that due to altered nerve conduction. And in the most part, you're going to be looking between your kind of local versus your systemic effects. I mean, monitoring for both of these and deciding whether or not you're going to need to treat. So local symptoms mainly being the swelling, ecchymosis, and necrosis of tissue that's occurring. And the systemic effects are going to be more of the coagulopathies that develop. So again, the local reactions, you're going to see painful swelling, can be very, very, very painful. These patients, paresthesias rarely, and they have this ecchymosis, blistering, and tissue necrosis that occurs. In rare cases, you might have rhabdomyolysis. There's a particular snake called a canebrake. You see more in Georgia, not so much in Florida, but can occur. And again, looking at the degree of toxicity, you're going to see that rattlesnakes will be the most prominent, followed by your moccasins, followed by your copperheads. Again, systemically, you're going to expect to see, just due to the fact that they've been bitten by a snake, there's a lot of fear, a lot of pain, anxiety comes along with this. You may see some nausea, vomiting, tachycardia associated with it. Rarely do you have renal failure, but can it happen if you had rhabdo developing? And then actually there are some snakes, some pit vipers over on the West Coast, like the Mojave rattlesnake, which actually has a neurotoxin in its venom. But the main thing you're going to be seeing systemically is going to be these hematologic effects. Again, platelets going down, fibrinogen going down, PTINR, PTT can be going up. So as far as how we manage these snakes, if you had a bite that came in and the patient looks completely asymptomatic, one of the things you want to do is watch for at least 8 to 12 hours, because depending on how slowly that venom is leaking into the circulation, you may not see effects for this period of time. So some of the things you want to warn your patients not to do, you don't want to put a tourniquet on because it's going to cut off blood flow and can lead to further tissue, ischemic tissue damage that can occur. Again, a lot of people's first instinct is like, well, I got to stop the flow of the venom. Let's go ahead and put a wrap on it. That's not going to be good though long term, because what we end up having to do is be able to slowly take that off. Because if you take off the tourniquet too quickly, you're going to have a lot of rapid influx of venom leading to some cardiovascular toxicity. We also do not recommend sucking or cutting out the venom. It's not going to be super useful, although it is a good test to see if your friends are actually your friends or not. They'll do this for you. And then some of the other things you want to assess in your patients to look to see if their tetanus is up to date. I'll tell you, a lot of our male patients who are coming in probably don't have their tetanus status up to date. And you want to assess for allergies, specifically if you're looking for things like papaya allergy, latex allergies, because that can be part of those components are involved in the antidote. And then you also want to look at previous antivenin administration, because if they've received the antivenin before, maybe a slight risk that they're going to develop develop an allergic reaction to it later. And we'll see why that is in a moment. And then give them medications for pain and anxiety. Oftentimes, they need to be managed with pretty hefty doses of opioids, IV morphine, things like that, in order to help deal with the pain. So again, some of the things you're going to be doing is going to be measuring circumferential measurements. So again, putting kind of measuring tape around the limb that's affected. Usually want to do every 15 minutes initially to look for not only increases in the actual girth of the limb, but also in the leading edge of, see how far the swelling has progressed. And then basically mark with the width of the tape. They use two lines, so you know exactly where to put the tape. Otherwise, I might have someone measuring on one side of the line versus the other side of the line, and you can get differences in measurements, which might lead to some inappropriate treatment decisions. Again, as far as laboratory testing goes, monitoring platelets, your PTINR, PTT, and fibrinogen is going to be useful here. So initially, they'll do it at a baseline, and then again in 6 hours. And then rarely do you have to do surgical intervention. A lot of times the envenomation with the amount of swelling you have can kind of mimic compartment syndrome, but rarely this is ever needed. Certainly fasciotomies are done in the past, digitotomies, but most often you don't really need to do this. The answer is going to be more of the anti-venom. And then finally, blood products. Rarely do we need to give these for the coagulopathies. Usually the answer again is going to be more anti-venom. Again, just an example of one of the fasciotomies that had been done on a limb previously. You can see how quite swollen it is in the top picture, and then kind of what happened afterwards. Obviously, this leads to a lot of disfigurement, and we like to avoid this if we can. I can honestly say I've never been party to one where we've had to do a fasciotomy for these patients. Usually, they can be managed just with anti-venom alone. So, the way they're going to treat this is going to be by using an anti-venom called Crofab. And essentially what happens is that we will take a sheep, which, it's ovine derived, and so we'll actually inject it with the venom from the western diamondback, the eastern diamondback, the Mojave rattlesnake, and also the cottonmouth. And notice here that like the copperhead's not mentioned here. Notice how the pygmy rattlesnake's not here, but there's enough homology between the components of the venom that you can actually make an anti-venom from these four snake venoms and use it across all these different type of pit vipers. So essentially, you inject the sheep with the venoms. It generates antibodies to that, and then we pull out the sheep's blood, isolate the antibodies. And then from there, normally full antibodies are very, especially from animal sources, are going to be very immunogenic and cause a lot of anaphylaxis. We'll see that when we talk about the coral snake antivenom in a minute. But the big thing here is that we utilize certain proteins like papain, which actually comes from papaya. And it actually helps to cleave off part of the FC portion of the, or close out the entire FC portion of the antibody. So you're left with just the FAB portions. This is where you get the name Crofab from. And so by giving that, it's able to bind up the anti-venom or bind up the venom without causing as much of an immune an allergic reaction. So again, the way or the indications we're going to use to treat this is if we see significant progression of swelling. So I normally say if it crosses a major joint, so say the patient got bitten in the finger and now it's crossed the wrist, I would say that would definitely be an indication. Certainly, if they have any degree of coagulopathy or any kind of hemodynamic or neuromuscular compromise. Initially, we bolus with several vials up front, and notice here there's not adult and peds dosing. That's mainly because when the snake bites you, it doesn't really care if whether or not you're a kid or an adult. It just gives you all the venom it's got. So because of that, the we kind of gauge how many vials you need based on how symptomatic you are. Obviously, if you're bitten 15 minutes ago and your arm is twice the size of the unaffected limb, we're going to be shooting more for the 6 vials. Whereas if it's been several hours, maybe you have a slight coagulopathy, maybe 4 vials might be better off. So we give it over an hour or so, and then we actually will end up doing some maintenance dosing because we cleave that FAB, because we cleave the antibody just to have the FAB portion of it. It doesn't stick around in the body for as long, so we end up having to do some maintenance dosing every 6 hours for 3 doses in order to help maintain that degree of neutralization of the venom. And then typically, once they're done with the maintenance, watch them for another 24 hours to make sure they don't have any recurrence of symptoms. There's been cases previously where people have had a recurrence of coagulopathy several hours after finishing up the Crofab dosing and ended up having to be retreated because of that. So again, one of the big things when you give Crofab is it's never going to reverse the swelling that's already occurred. It mainly is going to stop the swelling from getting any worse. At least initially, it's going to take time for that swelling to go down. In the rare cases where a patient does have an allergic reaction to this antivenom, you may need to treat through it. So, give them the epi, the Benadryl, the steroids, but because you still need to neutralize that snake venom, you're still going to end up treating through it. It's really important for these patients when they're finished up, they follow up with their PCP for repeat coags 1 week later, and then let them know if they've ever had. They get bitten by a snake again, let them know they've had Crofab before because of the fact that they may have a small chance for an allergic reaction to occur. They also have a risk for developing what we call serum sickness, which is essentially a delayed kind of immunogenic response to those foreign proteins. Kind of like flu-like symptoms, usually pretty self-limited. So normally just treat with some antipyretics like acetaminophen and they're usually good to go. But in rare cases, they need to be brought in for an evaluation. And then obviously they're going to be prone, somewhat prone to bleeding for the week or two after they've been discharged. So they may need to be rescheduling elective procedures and things like that to prevent excessive bleeding from occurring. Okay, so then moving on from the pit vipers, we'll move on to the Elapidae or the coral snakes. So the coral snakes, the big thing you have to worry about in Florida is going to be this eastern coral snake. And so the way we identify these guys is because they don't have the big hinge fangs like the pit vipers. They don't have elliptical pupils. They don't really have any of those telltale features. The big thing we do here is by looking at the banding pattern on the snakes. So what we do is we'll look at the red on yellow, kill a fellow. So red on yellow, or red bands touching yellow bands means it's a poisonous snake. Red on black, venom lack. So over here, over the scarlet king snake, which is not a venomous, has red bands touching black bands. Some people remember it as when you're at a, going up to a stoplight, it goes yellow, then red, means you need to stop. Some people use that as a mnemonic to remember which banding pattern, but just remember red on yellow, kill a fellow. It's the easiest way to do it. What I usually tell people is if it's red on yellow, run the hell away. If it's red on black, run the hell away. It doesn't matter what the color of the snake is. I say just don't pick up snakes and you're usually good to go. These snakes are typically pretty docile for the most part. So usually you're going to see more bites occurring from people picking them up. The other thing is that they don't have the big hypodermic needles of fangs that the pit vipers have. So they have very small fangs. And when they are going to inject their venom, they really need to sit there and chew on whatever it is they're biting. So typically, a lot of these snakes will give kind of defensive bites or they'll bite and they'll fall off. And you don't really have to worry about envenomation there. However, if they bite and they hold on when they start their chewing and you actually have to physically pull the snake off, that's usually a pretty good sign they've injected some degree of venom into the patients. Some people will describe it as kind of like pulling off Velcro. The venom here is much different than you would see with the pit vipers. Here, you're going to see it's mainly a neurotoxin. It has these curare-like effects, meaning it's preventing the effects of acetylcholine from activating the nicotinic acetylcholine receptors, meaning it's mainly going to be affecting neuronal transmission and affecting skeletal muscle movement. So you typically see very minor local effects, maybe a little bit of swelling, and then you can have very delayed effects as well. So some patients won't actually manifest symptoms until 12 hours after they've actually been bitten. So because of that, it's not really easy to distinguish dry bites from those that are actually envenomated. What you're going to see are these systemic effects where you end up having slurred speech, paresthesias, ptosis, dysphagia, stridor, and it goes all the way up until you have respiratory paralysis, in which case you may need to intubate the patient. And then when I actually did my research in fellowship, you actually see that the coral snake patients, when they were needing to be intubated, it ended up taking them roughly 8 days in order to get off the vent. So it can be very, very pronounced, very prolonged if you don't get the antivenom on in time. And so this paralysis is completely reversible, but it does take time to occur. So the idea is, and again here, the antivenom is never going to reverse the symptoms that are already occurring. It's only going to prevent it from getting worse. So you want to get, so time is really of the essence. You want to get this drug on as soon as you start to see these symptoms. So for patients who are asymptomatic, you need to watch them for at least 24 hours from the time they arrive in the ED. So usually that means going to the ICU and being watched with frequent neuro checks. And again, no first aid measures are really proven effective here. I always say the best piece of first aid you can have for a snake bite is going to be a set of car keys. And again, getting yourself to the healthcare facility before symptoms start is going to be the best thing to do. And then again, once you're in the ED here, look for tetanus status, assess for any allergies or if they've had previous antivenom here before. And then obviously be treating things like pain and anxiety. And then there's no real need for prophylactic antibiotics, but anytime you have a snake bite, you want to make sure you clean off the wound pretty thoroughly just to prevent any secondary infections from occurring. And then you need frequent neuro checks to look for any onset of these symptoms, whether it be paresthesias, whether it be ptosis, anything like that. Those are the things you want to be looking for with these patients. Now, the antivenom that we're going to give here is going to be the coral snake antivenom, and this one actually is of equine origin. And so as opposed to the ovine origin you saw with the crow fab, this one you're going to have it come from horses. And this one is the full antibody. So again, we immunize horses against these different coral snake venoms and then isolate out those antibodies, and then we just inject that into the patients. Again, because it's the full antibody, it's very, very immunogenic. Problem is this is actually no longer produced. And so we actually, all of the lots of this drug actually went out of date several years ago, but the FDA has been doing some testing on it to make sure it still is good. And so we have very limited supplies of this drug. So we try to limit who we actually give this to those that are actually symptomatic. Benefit though is you only have to give one dose for the most part, usually 3 to 5 vials initially, and then you kind of repeat based if they don't have enough of a response. But rarely do you need to give more than the 3 to 5 vials. Now, because this is so immunogenic, one of the things you can do is actually skin test the patient by giving a small blob of it intradermally and seeing if they have a Whelan flare reaction. Just because they have a negative reaction here does not mean they won't have a bad reaction when they have it infused intravenously, but it can help guide you to see if you need to have a pretreat with some of your anaphylaxis meds, so giving steroids and diphenhydramine beforehand. But remember just to keep that resuscitation equipment on hand and treat if you need to. And again, because this is the full antibody, serum sickness is much more likely. It's almost 100% if you give 5 vials, so it's good to warn your patients. They're going to be coming down with the flu-like syndrome a week after they get out of the hospital. Okay, moving on. Next thing we'll talk about are caterpillars, something you might not necessarily think to be all that dangerous. We have a couple of different caterpillars that reside in Florida. So one here, you have the saddleback. Obviously, you can tell where he got his name from. You have the pus or puce caterpillar here. He's kind of one of these fuzzy guys. Again, very common exposure in Florida. You have the IO moth. And then finally, you have the hag caterpillar here. So the poisonous part of these caterpillars is going to be the toxins that are found on the actual hairs. And so we'll see that the damage that's occurring is not only from the mechanical irritation from them being pierced through the skin, but also going to be due to the toxins that are contained therein. So the clinical effects you can expect to see after a caterpillar sting, otherwise known as lepidopterism, is going to be a lot of local effects. Main thing is going to be lots and lots of pain. Usually it's going to be out of proportion to what the actual site looks like itself. I've seen grown men crying in pain, even though the site looks maybe a little red, but beyond that, it doesn't really look all that bad. May have a little bit of swelling, maybe some tingling and numbness, but the pain is going to be the big thing you're going to see here, which may actually lead to some vomiting in cases. And then rarely do you have patients who, if they've been exposed, may have irritation to the eyes or the throat, although that's pretty rare. And then some patients will just end up having an outright allergic reaction to the actual exposure. Some of the ways we can treat this are with decontamination. So this is where our handy friend duct tape comes in play. You can actually use the sticky part of the tape here to actually remove the hairs. Any kind of adhesive will do. Once you remove the hairs with the tape, then you can actually use soap and water to clean off the area. Certainly, if they're having any kind of reaction, antihistamines might be useful here. And then pain management is going to be the big thing. I've seen some stings where repeated doses of morphine have been needed just in order to get the pain under control. But sometimes it takes a lot because these can be so painful. And then obviously, you can manage allergic reactions as you would normally. Another creepy critter to talk about would be scorpions. So lots of different varieties of scorpions that are out there, and you'll actually see that a lot of the lethal ones are not going to be contained in Florida, fortunately. You can actually see here how they kind of fluoresce under black light, which I think is kind of cool. But the big thing you're going to be seeing is that the sting is going to be coming from their tail section, this telson. And they see that, in places like the tropics and North Africa, there's over 100,000 medically significant stings that occur. But fortunately, in Florida, you'll see that these stings are really no worse than bee stings for the most part, mainly because our scorpions are not that big. Rarely do you see mortality in patients over the age of 6, but certainly in those very, very young patients, they can be more prone to significant morbidity and mortality just due to the fact they don't have a whole lot of physiologic reserve as an adult might. So we have several thousand exposures that occur in the U.S. annually. Again, mostly you're going to see more exposure in the Southwest, so places like New Mexico, Nevada. And the main variety here you're going to see the Centroides exiculata, otherwise known as the bark scorpion. That's probably one of the more common varieties. Again, here in Florida, you see that they're a lot smaller, so they're going to be more prone to kind of equate them to like a bee sting than you would, say, a more significant sting you would have in the Southwest. They have very complex venom, has all kind of things like hyaluronidase, serotonin, acetylcholinesterases. And we see that some of the other things their neurotoxin does is open up these sodium channels and cause repetitive depolarization. So this can include both activation of parasympathetic and sympathetic nerves. Not only that, but you can also have increases in catecholamine release and also some renin secretion. So as you might imagine, you have all kinds of interesting clinical effects popping up from these toxins. Now, locally, you're expecting to see a lot of intense pain, erythema, tingling, or burning. In some cases, you may have some discoloration, necrosis of the tissue, which can last some long period of time, anywhere between 5 and 30 hours. The big thing you worry about, especially in young children, especially in the Southwest with these larger scorpions, is a systemic reaction that can occur. Due to activation of these different neurons, you're going to be having autonomic storm. We have a lot of cholinergic and androgenergic effects. So it's kind of like a cholinergic toxidrome on top of the sympathomimetic toxidrome. Some cases see dysrhythmias, maybe MI, EKG changes like QT prolongation, MI type patterns. And then you also worry about things like pancreatitis, coagulopathies, seizures, acute lung injury, shock. So all kinds of different bad things can happen when you have, especially in those individuals who are more sensitive to the effects. Rarely do we see these are going to produce severe toxicity. Obviously, good wound care is going to be important here along with pain management and make sure their tetanus status is up to date. Not a whole lot of great therapies we have at our hands. Some patients, in order to help kind of deal with this autonomic storm, may require things like intravenous benzodiazepines or continuous IV midazolam. Rare cases, atropine may be useful, especially if you're having a lot of muscarinic signs and symptoms. And then actually nowadays, we used to use a goat-derived antivenom, but this new product called Anascorp is going to be the main one you see being utilized. It is a Fab2 fragment. Type antivenom, so it's kind of like the crow fab, except it has a small piece of the FC portion, so it actually sticks around and works for a longer period of time than you would see with a normal like fab type product. Again, you don't see this being used in the Southwest as opposed to anywhere here in the U.S. because again, or in the in Florida, mainly because these scorpions are really not that significant. Then there's a couple of spiders to worry about in Florida. The two big spiders to cover here are going to be our Lactrodectus mactans, otherwise known as the Black Widow, and then also the Loxosceles reclusa, otherwise known as the Brown Recluse or the Fiddleback Spider. You can see the fiddleback there on the right side of the screen. You can kind of see the middle of the abdomen there. So just as an introduction, almost all spiders are going to be considered venomous. There's just a few that aren't. Something like the hackled orb weaver. The main thing to note here is that most of them are not able to actually envenomate people because their fangs are simply not long or hard enough to actually penetrate human skin. With the exception of some of the ones we'll talk about here in Florida, those are some that can. The actual envenomation rate is really difficult to ascertain. One, because of the unreliable history. A lot of times the first question I ask after someone says they've been bitten by a spider is, did you actually see it? A lot of times there is a possible infectious etiology. I always hear about the MRSA spider that's hopping around biting people, giving them abscesses. And again, without the spider to identify, it's difficult to determine what kind of actual envenomation occurred. And there's a lot of propagation of misinformation, namely with the brown recluse. See a lot of people say, oh, I got bit by a brown recluse, when probably it was more like a staph infection more than anything else. With the Lactrodectus mactans, otherwise the widows. There's four species native to Florida. So there's like the southern black widow, the northern. The southern black widow is the main one that you kind of think about as having that kind of hour-shaped red glass on the abdomen, on the thorax, whatever part of the spider it is, on the big end. And then you also have things like the red widow here pictured, and also a brown widow. You typically see that the females are more likely responsible for bites, mainly because they're larger and their fangs are more likely to actually pierce skin. Normally they're going to form kind of irregularly shaped webs, and they're typically found in like outdoor restrooms or barns, sheds, places like that. Usually pretty shy, but it can be can prompt a bite if you interrupt their habitat. They, on a milligram per milligram basis, have a more potent venom than you would see with pit vipers, but the thing is that the spider's so small, it doesn't inject nearly as much as a snake might. Usually with the bites from the widows, you see a pretty painful bite. Usually a pair of red spots will end up developing from where the fangs got them. And you generally see kind of a limited local effect. Usually maybe a little bit of redness, maybe a little bit of swelling, but not much beyond that. The main toxin here is called alpha-latrotoxin. And so this is going to work by opening a lot of non-specific cation channels, allowing a lot of influx and efflux of different ions, But one of the big things you see is a big influx in calcium. This is also going to increase release of things like acetylcholine and norepinephrine. So this is going to be responsible for some of the clinical effects we'll see. The clinical effects can be kind of characterized as a term called latrodectism. Usually the bite itself will be pretty painful within 30 minutes to 2 hours or so. And then by 3 to 4 hours, you have very painful cramping in some of these fasciculations. And again, a lot of that's due to the calcium being released. A lot of it's due to the acetylcholines being released. You see the cramping kind of progresses centripetally. And in rare cases, you can see this kind of board-like rigidity develop. Other things you can see is potentially hypertension. Could lead to crisis if it's in a patient who has already kind of poor blood pressure control. Certainly see things like tachycardia. Interestingly enough, you can see kind of regional diaphoresis where maybe the affected limb is sweating whereas nothing else is. Then seeing things like nausea, vomiting, and respiratory arrest in some rare cases. The treatment for these guys these bites are mainly going to be pretty supportive for the most part. Do some good wound care, make sure the tetanus is up to date. And again, these bites are very, very painful. So kind of similar to the caterpillars, you may see pain that's kind of out of proportion with the actual site looks like. So sometimes IV opiates are needed in order to manage that pain. Some people feel that by giving IV calcium, you may help with some kind of temporary relief of some of the pain and the cramping that occurs, but it's pretty transient for the most part. We do have an antivenom, and again, it's a very old product that's equine-derived, similar to the coral snake antivenom. And so there's a big risk for anaphylaxis here. And then for the most part, you don't need it. Most of the time, symptomatic care, giving some muscle relaxants or some IV opioids are enough to kind of manage the pain issues. But in some patients who are either very old, very young, or potentially pregnant who cannot tolerate a lot of the hypertensive effects may receive this. So just know there is an antivenom out there, but you rarely ever see it used. The one time I did see it used was in an 11-month-old that had been bitten. Had very significant hypertension that was able to be reversed after giving the antivenom. Usually recovery is going to happen within 24 to 48 hours. Most of these patients, if you can get the pain under control, you can send them out on their way. Don't necessarily need to admit for observation or anything like that. Here's an example of a non-venomous spider, just in case you're curious. And then the other category of venomous spiders to look for in Florida are going to be the Loxosceles reclusa, otherwise known as the fiddleback spider or the brown recluse. Again, you typically, if you look at the range of where the brown recluses live, they don't typically thrive in Florida. It's even in the central and southeastern U.S., not typically indigenous here, but you may have some isolated nests, especially if you have some hitchhikers that come in on people's clothing or luggage or things like that. And as the name implies, they're pretty reclusive by nature, and so they're not out there trying to bite people on purpose, but usually the bites are going to be more defensive, if anything. And so typically because of the clinical effects you see from these bites, they're going to get blamed for a lot more bites than they actually occur. So the thing we call this is going to be this necrotic arachnidism. And essentially what you're having here is that the venom itself contains a product called hyaluronidase, which breaks down tissue, and also sphingomyelinase D. And so essentially what's happening is you have this kind of breakdown of tissue, this necrosis that occurs. You also have kind of like a local inflammatory reaction where you have white blood cells attracting to the site, which can produce actually a systemic hemolysis that can occur rarely. Looking at the bite progression, you generally are going to see over 24 to 72 hours kind of this necrotic core, this necrotic ulcer forming. It's very slow healing. It can take a long time for it to heal. And you kind of this bullseye lesion that occurs. Again, you see kind of this like red core. You're going to have the kind of this blue kind of area of ecchymosis and then kind of this white blanching of skin outside of that. So it's called this kind of bullseye type lesion. The other systemic symptoms can be considered, the name for it is loxosceleism. And so you can see fevers and chills, myalgias. And then the thing we worry about, especially for very young patients who get bitten, are potentially this intravascular hemolysis and then a DIC type fixture where they have this coagulopathy that occurs. Unfortunately, there's no good treatment for these kind of bites. Wound care is really going to be the biggest thing. Some people will try giving Dapsone, which is kind of an older school antimicrobial agent, which we didn't really touch on too much, but Dapsone may potentially be used to help reduce some of the severity of these ulcers. Other therapies we could look at, there's no antivenom that's really readily available, but some people might try things like hyperbaric oxygen for the wound to help enhance the healing there. But one thing that people try to do is try to excise this necrotic core. But unfortunately, by doing that, you actually end up causing it to spread even further. So excision is not really recommended for these kind of bites. Okay, and then one of the last sections we'll talk about are going to be marine envenomations. Again, being in Florida, going to the beach, these marine envenomations definitely occur with some regularity. The first group we'll talk about are the cnidaria, and these are going to include our jellyfishes. And so essentially, there's many, many different types of species, maybe about 100 or so cause actual injury. And then all species have these cnidae, which essentially are these barbed threads that are ejected from the organism that contain a venom. Collectively, they're kind of known as these nematocysts. And essentially what's happening is they can be triggered by lots of different things. So it could be changes in pressure, could be changes in osmotic influences on the cells, or different chemical interactions can cause these to fire off and sting. As far as the different types of prevalent envenomations that occur from jellyfish, one of the big ones are going to be the cubozoa. These are not true jellyfish. But they typically are going to be producing the most morbidity and mortality. So these would be the things like you'd be seeing over in Australia. So these include like your box jellyfish, which you see over here on the left, and then also this Irukandji jellyfish, which causes a little bit different type of toxicity. You have the hydrozoa. Again, these are not true jellyfish, but these probably are the ones that you're going to see most often in Florida. So you have these Portuguese man-o-war here on the left, and also the blue bottle jellyfish. And then these are much larger organisms. Sometimes the tentacles may measure more than 100 feet long in some cases. You have the scyphozoa. These are the true jellyfish. It will include things like sea nettle and lion's mane. And then you also have the anemones. Again, you have these sporocysts and they can live amongst these reefs and kind of propagate there. So as far as the pathophysiology, there's lots of different components to the venom. They can cause hemolysis, myonecrosis, dermatonecrosis. In some rare cases, you can actually end up seeing this cardiovascular collapse. A lot of it can be due to blocking neuronal conduction, blocking nerve conduction, some of these ion channels. And then sometimes there can be an allergic component to it as well. Specifically, the Irukandji, you can actually end up seeing increased catecholamine release, so it kind of causes this more sympathomimetic type picture. Looking at the clinical manifestations, you see that few stings really cause systemic symptoms. Usually, they're going to cause a lot of more local skin effects, as you can see in the picture here. Box jellyfish themselves are going to be causing more severe pain for the most part. But again, most of what you're going to see is this kind of erythematous linear rash and pain at the site. Systemically, though, you can potentially see things like nausea, vomiting, muscle spasms, headache, and chills. Now, the box jellyfish, again, these are one of the more likely ones to actually cause mortality. Most are going to suffer local pain, but what you can end up seeing is this kind of progression of vertigo, ataxia, followed by paralysis and syncope. And so, kind of the classic thing that people will describe is them getting stung in the water. They know they've been stung by something, so they start to make it to shore, but then eventually pass out, unfortunately, and are unable to really save themselves due to the paralysis. If they do end up making it to shore, you have to worry about things like hemolysis, pulmonary edema occurring, and then potentially even acute renal failure. And then typically, children are going to be more vulnerable to this than older patients. With the Irukandji jellyfish, they undergo this syndrome called Irukandji syndrome. Again, it's pretty limited local effects, so not a ton of pain as compared to some of the other ones you can see. But then within 30 minutes or so, you're going to have this systemic catecholamine surge, where you're going to have tachycardia, palpitations, headache, and diaphoresis. Also, this kind of impending sense of doom in these severe back spasms that can occur. So those are probably the most toxic of the bunch, the box jellyfish and the Irukandji. Fortunately, most of those are not going to be found here in Florida. You'll see more of those in the Pacific Ocean, Australia especially. With the Portuguese man-o-war, again, those are going to be the ones you see more often in Florida. Again, severe pain. Sometimes you can see skin necrosis and bile. And then some systemic symptoms can occur, mostly weakness, numbness, anxiety, but these are more rare for the most part. Again, mainly going to be the local effects you're going to see here. There's also this manifestation called sea bather's eruption. This is actually due to larvae from these certain organisms. They end up producing this pruritic papular rash. And essentially, what happens here is that when you're out swimming, you may actually have these larvae. They actually can embed themselves within your bathing suit. You may not know about it at the time, but later on, when you're say you put the bathing suit back on, or you're washing off or something like that, that can actually cause the nitrate to actually to fire. And so you typically see this deposition along where the bathing suit actually is. Usually the duration is going to be somewhat long, but less than 2 weeks for the most part. So for the most part, there's kind of a lot of conflicting data on what you should use in order to decontaminate the body when you do have some of these tentacles and things like that on you. What you end up seeing is that for certain species, you may see the vinegar inhibits nematocyst discharge, but it may actually enhance it in certain other species. So actually here in Florida, you don't want to actually put vinegar on them because it may actually end up causing more firing of the nidae and cause more pain. Things like urine and ethanol are also not going to be very useful because they can actually enhance the discharge due to changes in osmolarity and pH and things like that. There is a product that's available called Stingos, which contains surfactant and aluminum sulfate, which can actually be useful in order to help decontaminate. It's kind of formulated to help prevent the nidae from firing. And then, but for the most part, the easiest thing to do is just use seawater. So I most of the times will recommend to people if they have seawater available, since that's what the jellyfish are in most of the time, they're less likely to fire in that. So if you can use seawater to help get that off, use something like a Visa or a credit card, something like that, in order to help kind of use this kind of like a spatula to get the tentacles off. Or if you don't have that around, use some kind of lubricant, water-based lubricant work just fine in order to help get that off. There is a box jellyfish antivenom. It's available in Australia only because, again, that's mainly where the box jellyfish live. Unfortunately, again, most patients that receive it, some of them might actually make it short to actually get it in the first place. But those patients who would get it would be those that are developing things like arrhythmia, respiratory depression, or coma. There's been some limited data to say things like verapamil and magnesium might actually help with some of this catecholamine release that can occur. Again, you have some of that occurring with the box jellyfish as well. But again, not a ton of literature out there since the envenomations are not super frequent. And then you also have your fish. Lots of different types of stinging fish that are out there. Again, most of the time you're going to be seeing more actual physical trauma than you are going to be seeing a lot of toxins associated with these, but certainly some of them still have some toxic degree. Looking at the different varieties here, you can have things like different types of rays can be stinging. And certainly you have this class of fish called the Scorpidae, which are going to include like your lionfish and your stonefish. Notice things like your lionfish are going to be those that are kept as kind of kept in a lot of ocean or saltwater aquariums and things like that. So you can end up seeing kind of home exposures to these, even in places where the ocean may not be so close. So usually when you end up seeing stingray stings, it's usually from them being stepped on. They have a very long barb that comes out of their tail that kind of whips up on top of the ray. So typically you see people getting barbed in the leg after stepping on them. Most deaths, though, are going to occur from the trauma, not necessarily from the venom that they do have. Again, you remember Steve Irwin, he unfortunately was killed by a stingray. And then with the spiny fish, you're going to be seeing a lot of fishermen and waders getting either stepping on them or handling them. And then the collectors as well are going to be the ones being stung here. You see a lot of them are being found in the Gulf and in the Keys. And so the majority of the calls we get at the poison center are going to deal with the lionfish. Again, these are most often the ones you're going to see in a lot of saltwater aquariums. So, of course, they're going to be most frequent. Again, with the stingrays, they have venoms that contain a lot of things like serotonin, phosphodiesterase, and other amino acids. They're going to be causing vasoconstriction, bradycardia, seizures, coma, all the way up to cardiovascular collapse. So you can see that, again, if the trauma is not enough, you're going to have all these kind of other systemic effects that can occur from the sting as well. With the spiny fish, there's a few specific toxins that'll actually produce, one being the Stonas toxin. This one can be usually found in the stonefish. You can see it forms these hydrophilic pores in the membranes, which can cause hemolysis and edema, platelet aggregation to occur. There's another type of toxin called the Veruca toxin, which can actually block cardiac calcium channels. As you might imagine, things like bradycardia can occur there. And then you also had this trichinellosin toxin as well, which actually increases catecholamine release and then acetylcholine-dependent calcium release. So you can kind of expect a lot of similar effects as you would see with something like the black widow venom there. So for the most part, these clinical manifestations occur after stepping on the body of a stingray. It causes that natural reflex. So initially what you're going to see there, we're going to have local edema, cyanosis of the tissue, and then potentially some erythema. And then eventually as the damage occurs, you're going to see necrosis and ulceration. Rarely you're going to have the systemic effects, but potentially you have nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, headache, and then even more rarely seizures and fasciculations can occur. The stonefish, they're going to be causing immediate pain. With those ones specifically, you have really rapid wound cyanosis and edema, and really kind of slow healing wounds associated with them as well. And again, systemic effects can occur here as well. Something a little bit more non-specific, like the headache and vomiting can happen. Usually when you have these kind of mechanical traumas, you're going to be doing a radiograph to make sure they don't have any retained foreign material here. In some cases, the stingray wounds can be severe enough, they actually require surgery in some cases. Again, look for tetanus prophylaxis. And one of the best things you can do for a lot of the pain is actually to use hot water. Water as hot as you can let the patient stand is going to be useful because it helps to denature a lot of the proteins. And so it actually helps to decrease a lot of the pain associated with them. Not only that, but you can also give some local and systemic analgesia. And then as far as antivenoms go, there's really only one, and this is going to be for the stonefish. This is actually an equine-derived Fab fragment. Again, not used very often. Mainly going to be more in places like Australia, where you're going to see these more frequently. So anyway, that's the end of the toxicology section. If you have any questions, please let me know. Otherwise, we can discuss more on Monday, and I'll see you guys then. Thanks.